हेलो गाइस, आई एम वैशाली किकान फ्रॉम वैशालीज ई लर्निंग एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट फिजिक्स एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द फर्स्ट चैप्टर ऑफ द फिजिक्स दैट इज मोशन. इन दिस प्लेलिस्ट वी विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट द डिफरेंट चैप्टर्स एंड इन वन चैप्टर वी विल बी सीइंग द थ्योरी पार्ट एज वेल एज द न्यूमेरिकल्स रिलेटेड टू इट. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल कवर द थ्योरी पार्ट एंड देन वी विल सी अ क्विक रिविजन विद द हेल्प ऑफ द न्यूमेरिकल्स. सो दिस प्ले लिस्ट इज रियली इंपॉर्टेंट एंड आई वॉन्ट ऑल ऑफ यू टू बी रेडी विद योर नोटबुक्स विद योर पेन्स सो दैट यू कैन प्रैक्टिस द न्यूमेरिकल्स एंड यू राइट डाउन द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट डेफिनेशंस दैट आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू गाइज, राइट? सो इन दिस मैनर यू कैन रिवाइज your basic chapters of the class 11 and the class 12 physics, chemistry as well as biology. We are going to do these playlists, right? So we are starting with the physics over here. We are starting with the motion chapter. So let's talk about the basic theory of the motion. Motion is a word which is used in the kinematics. So kinematics is a branch of physics which is dealing with the motion of the objects, right? So kinematics is the word which is composed of a Greek word. So it is composed of a Greek word, kinema. Kinema means cinema. And now some of you are confused how cinema is related to the motion. Yes, cinema is related to the motion. How it is related to the motion? Cinema is the thing where people watch motion pictures. When the pictures are in motion, we are calling it as cinema. When an object is in motion, we are calling it as kinematics, right? So study of the objects when these are in motion, it's a branch of physics called kinematics. And I hope now this thing is very clear to all of you. Now coming to the uniform motion. What is a uniform motion? It's a movement with a constant speed in a straight line. If I am moving with a constant speed in a one direction only, in a straight line only, then it is a uniform motion. Non-uniform motion is the movement that involves either change in speed or change in direction, or both change in speed as well as change in direction. So now you must know the difference between the uniform and the non-uniform motion. The basics must be very clear. Now coming to the scalar quantity, the quantity that has magnitude but no direction. So whenever I am talking about a quantity which is having just magnitude, like I am talking about mass. Mass is having just the magnitude. You are not saying 3 kg in which direction. You are not saying like that. 3 kg in the south direction, 3 kg in the west direction. It is not like that. So mass is a scalar quantity. After that, we are going to talk about the base units. Base units are the unit from which other units are derived or made up. So we have 7 base units, which are the base unit which we use to find out the different derived unit, right? So derived unit are made up of 7 base unit. We have some of the base units like meter, kilogram, seconds. So we have 4 more base units. So these 7 are the SI base units, and these SI base units are then used for the derived units. So what are the derived units that are derived using the 7 base units? So that can be stated in terms of 7 base units are the derived unit. Coming to the next concept, that is the instantaneous speed. So instantaneous speed and instantaneous velocity, both are really important. First of all, let's talk about the instantaneous speed. It is the speed of a particular instant. So when I start moving, let's suppose I am running in a particular direction. So now when I start running, I will be having, at the instant I am just starting running, at that time I will be having lesser speed. And when I am running after some instants, after some time, I will be having a greater speed. So at the initial level, just before the beginning, I will be having zero speed because I am just at a constant position, right? So that time speed would be zero. So now I hope you understood the instantaneous speed. At a particular instant, if you want to find out the speed of an object, that is the instantaneous speed. Coming to the average speed. What is an average speed? It is the total distance traveled divided by the total time taken by the traveling. So now when I'm traveling, I'm covering some distance. So if I travel to a particular distance, the total distance in between these two points divided by the total time I am taking from this point to this point is the average speed. So V average is represented as D upon T. D is the total distance, T is the total time. Now coming to the vector quantity. What are the vector quantity? Quantity that has both magnitude as well as direction. So if you want to represent any quantity which is having the magnitude as well as direction, like if you want to represent displacement, displacement is a vector quantity. You are moving in which direction you are representing when you are writing the displacement. So when you are representing magnitude and with it you are representing the direction as well, it is a vector quantity. Coming to the next term, that is position. Position is the distance and the direction of an object from the reference point. I can choose any reference point, and from the reference point if I have a distance as well as direction of any object, so that is my position. Distance as well as direction of object from the reference point. Coming to the displacement, I just talked about the displacement. It is having a magnitude as well as direction. It's a vector quantity. It is the change in the position of an object in a given direction. So displacement is actually different from the distance traveled. Distance traveled is the total distance traveled, right? So if first I am moving from north, south to north, then over here, then over here, and then again over here. So if in this case, so I am moving like this. So in this particular case, what will happen? The total distance, if I am traveling a kilometer in all of the directions, so the total distance traveled would be 4a kilometer, whereas the displacement, because I am starting from this point and I am ending up at this point only, so the initial point is this, final point is this, so displacement would be 0 in this case. So this is how the displacement and distance both are different, right? Now let's suppose if I stopped over here, right? If I stopped over here, so now the displacement would be this. From this initial point I to this final point F, if I make a vector, so this represents my displacement, right? So it will be having some magnitude. Magnitude is A and the direction is from I to F, right? So this is how I can represent the displacement. The velocity. Velocity is the rate of the change of the position. When the position is changing at a particular rate, we are calling it as a velocity. Average velocity. It is the change of the position divided by the time interval for that change in the given position, right? So now over here, V average can be written as delta D upon delta T. So when we are talking about the average velocity, I will be talking about the displacement of a point from a particular point and the total time taken from that point to a particular point, right? So if a person is moving from one position to another position, its displacement divided by the total time he took. So this is the average velocity. What would be the instantaneous velocity? The instantaneous velocity would be the velocity, the displacement per unit time for a particular instant, right? The straight line on a position time graph indicates the uniform motion and slope of the line, represent the average velocity between any two times, right? So if you have any graph which is representing a uniform motion, so let's suppose over here we have a graph which is representing a uniform motion, right? So now over here, this is a graph which is representing the uniform motion. So here the slope of this line from this time to this time represent, if I want to find out the slope of this line, you know now what is the slope of the line, you have studied in the basic mathematics. So if you find out the slope of this line, this will give you the average velocity between the time interval T2 and T1, right? So this is how you can use the graphs also to find out that the velocity. So this is a time displacement graph, right? Displacement time graph is used to find out the velocity. If it was distance time graph, it will give me the average speed, right? So the area under the line on a velocity time graph represents the displacement between any two times. Let's suppose this is my graph of velocity versus time. If I use the velocity versus time graph, I can find out the area under the line for a given interval of time. That will give me, this area will give me the total displacement. if this is my speed versus time graph, this area will give me the total distance, right? So now what is the resultant displacement? Displacement, because it's a vector quantity, if I have two or more displacement, the resultant displacement would be the vector sum of the individual displacement. So delta dr is delta d1 plus delta d2 plus delta d3 plus so on. Right, so this is how we can find out the resultant displacement. Coming to the frame of reference, what is a frame of reference? It's a coordinate system related to which a motion can be observed. Right, from a coordinate system I am observing a motion. So if I am at a earth, I am observing the motion from earth, so the frame of reference would be earth. So if you are standing on the earth, you are observing a train to be moving, so that time you are having the frame of reference of the earth. If you are inside the train, inside the moving train, then you have the frame of reference of the train, right? So the coming to the relative velocity. Relative velocity is the velocity of the body relative to a particular frame of reference. In a particular frame of reference, you will be having some velocity. If you move the frame of reference, if you move to a different frame of reference, you might see a different velocity. So the relative velocity you have to find out with a particular frame of reference only. So for that, for understanding this concept, let's have an example. If I have a large cruise boat, so the large cruise boat is having the velocity which is 5 meter per second in south direction. So you can see the velocity is represented with the direction over here. So velocity is 5 meter per second in the south direction, and this velocity is relative to the shore. So the frame of reference over here is shore, or I can say shore is present on the earth, so frame of reference is earth, right? So we can write it as the velocity of boat with respect to earth. So whatever the frame of reference is, you are going to write that over here to represent where you are standing and from where you are calculating the velocity. So you see over here it is VBE. So over here VB represents the velocity of the boat and E represents with respect to earth. So the frame of reference over here is earth. Now you can see, now we have a passenger. Passenger is having the velocity 3 meter per second in the south direction. But this velocity of the passenger is relative to the boat. So the passenger is jogging on the cruise, and here because he is jogging on the cruise, now the passenger is having its velocity with respect to the boat. With respect to the boat, the passenger is moving at 3 meter per second in the south direction. In the direction where the cruise is moving, passenger is also moving in the same direction. So this is the passenger's relative velocity with respect to boat. The frame of reference over here is boat. So this is VPB. If I want to find out the passenger's velocity relative to the shore, I have to add these two velocity. So passenger's velocity VPS or VPE we have to find out. VPE represents the passenger's velocity with respect to earth. So VPE is VPB plus VBE, right? So over here you can see how to write this equation. So here we have V, P and E. So over here, first of all, you are going to write V, P. The first term over here, first term is P. So you are going to write V, P, right? Then over here, the second term is E. You are going to write the second term over here as E. So with respect to what is the third parameter over here? The boat. So over here, the second term would be boat, and here the first term would be boat. So if I have V, P, E, the first term over here would be P, and the second term over here would be E, right? So this the second term, second place is empty, we are filling it with B. Here first place was empty, we are filling it with B. So VPE is equal to VPB plus VBE. This is a trick that you can use. So VPB, it is given VPB, it is given 3 meter per second in south. VBE is also given, it is 5 meter per second in south. So 3 plus 5 gives me 8 meter per second in south. And here one thing you must remember, that earth is the most common frame of reference in most of the condition. Now till now we have studied the uniform motion. Now we are moving towards the non-uniform motion, when we have the accelerated motion. Accelerated motion is a non-uniform motion that involves the change in the object speed or direction or both. Whenever the object speed is changing or object's direction is changing, or both speed as well as direction is changing, I can say the object's acceleration is changing, and thus I can say the non-uniform motion are the accelerated accelerated motion. Now coming to the uniformly accelerated motion. What is uniformly accelerated motion? The motion that occurs when an object traveling in straight line changes its speed uniformly with time. The object is changing its speed uniformly with time, right? So if you have some acceleration is increasing uniformly with respect to time, right? So let's suppose you are increasing the acceleration of your car by, let's suppose, 1 meter per second square, right? Uniformly at every instant you are increasing, after every 1 second you are increasing by 1 meter per second square, after again you after 1 second you are increasing with 1 meter per second square. This is the uniformly accelerated motion. What is acceleration? Acceleration is the rate of change of velocity, right? If I change the velocity, if I observe it with respect to time, then I will call it as an acceleration. Coming to the instantaneous acceleration, as the name suggests, it's the acceleration at a particular instant. Coming to the average acceleration, what is an average acceleration? It is a change of velocity divided by the time interval for that change, right? So you are changing the velocity, you are changing the time, the change in velocity divided by the change in time is the average acceleration. Average acceleration is change of velocity upon the time interval. A average can be represented as delta V upon delta T. So delta V bar, over here we have this bar. Bar represent that the velocity is a vector quantity. So how I am going to write delta V? Delta V is the change in the velocity. It is the final velocity minus the initial velocity upon delta T. So A average is Vf minus Vi upon delta T. Bar signifies that the velocity is a vector quantity again. Now if I have a velocity time graph of uniform acceleration, right? Here I have a velocity time graph, and if I want to find out the slope in between this time T1 and T2, so slope will give me, for the velocity time graph, slope will give me the acceleration, right? Slope will give me the value of average acceleration between the any two times, right? If I find out the slope in between T1 and T2, it is giving me the average acceleration in between T1 and T2. The position time graph of uniform acceleration will be the curve whose slope continually changes. If I have a uniformly accelerated motion, and for that I am making the position time graph, right? The displacement time graph I am making, it will be having a slope which is continuously changing. Slope will be changing at every instant, right? At every instant, either the direction is changing or the magnitude of the slope is changing. So tangent to the curve, if I find out the tangent, it will give me the velocity. Tangent to displacement time graph will give me the velocity, right? Which is this velocity will be used to find out the acceleration. How? So you can find out the velocity at this instant, you can find out the velocity at this instant. So this would be my velocity at time t2, this would be my velocity at time t1. So if you find out v1 and v2 velocity at time t2 and t1 by finding out the slope of displacement versus time graph, you can find out v2 and v1. From v2 and v1, you know the distance between the change between the time t2 and t1. You know the delta T, you know the delta V, you can find out the average acceleration with this graph also. So if you have a velocity time graph, you can find out the acceleration. If you have displacement time graph, then also you can find out the acceleration, right? If you have the velocity time graph, then if you find out the area, it will give you the displacement. If you have the acceleration time graph, let's suppose you have the acceleration time graph, right? And if you find out the area, so this area will give you the velocity, right? So area in between this time T2 and T1 will give you the velocity, right? So this is the average velocity. Now coming to the tangent technique. Tangent technique is a method of determining velocity on a position time graph by drawing a line tangent to that curve and calculating the slope. Like here we used, I had a distance time graph, right? Over that we found out the tangent, and the tangent gave me the amount of velocity over here. So the tangent technique is method to determine velocity on a position time graph with the help of the tangent on that curve. So now what is a tangent? Tangent is a straight line that touches the curve only at a single point, right? If I have a curve, a tangent will be touching this curve at only a single point. So like, let's suppose this is a curve, I want to draw a tangent. So tangent would be like this. It is touching the curve only at a single point, right? So it touches the curve at a single point and has the same slope as the curve at that point. If I see over here, at this point the tangent and the curve are having the same slope. This is the tangent. So acceleration due to gravity. Acceleration due to gravity is a vector quantity. You are going to use this thing and we are going to talk in detail about the acceleration due to gravity, why it happens, why we have the acceleration due to gravity. First of all, just know that the acceleration due to gravity is a vector quantity. Acceleration itself is a vector quantity. Acceleration due to gravity will also be a vector quantity. It is having the magnitude 9.8 meter per second square and the direction in the downward direction. Acceleration due to gravity will always have the direction in the downward direction. It is having the symbol g. So it is represented with bar to represent it's a vector quantity. Now coming to the terminal speed. Terminal speed is a maximum speed of a falling object. So if I have a falling object, so this falling object will be having a maximum speed at which point the speed remain constant and there is no further acceleration. If I remove the acceleration, now initially the body will be having acceleration. Now if I remove the acceleration, the maximum speed this object is going to attain is the terminal speed. Now coming to the solving of the uniform acceleration problems. We will be seeing some problems. In the next part of this video, you are going to see some numerical problems. Over there, you are going to use the equation for the uniformly accelerated motion. So we have various variables. We have the general equation and we will be using which is the variable eliminated. And according to our requirement, we will be using a particular equation. So if I have the variables, acceleration v final, v initial and delta t. So I'm going to use the average acceleration is v final minus v initial upon delta t. Here I have eliminated the variable, the displacement delta d. If I have the variables delta d, v initial, a average and delta t, let's suppose in a question I am not given the v final, right? I am not using it in the problem statement, as well as I don't need to find it also. So if I have only the involvement of these four variables delta d, vi, a average and delta t, I am going to use this equation. Delta d is equal to vi delta t plus half a average delta t square. So now coming to the next equation, that is involving the variable delta d, vi, vf and delta t, right? So here I'm not using the average acceleration. So I know delta d is v average delta t, right? So or I can write the v average as half v initial plus v final. So delta d is half v initial plus v final into delta t. Now if I have the variables v final, v initial, a average and delta t, I don't have the delta t, I don't require delta t, I have eliminated the variable delta t. So the equation that I am going to use, v final square minus v initial square is equal to 2a average delta d. So or v final square is equal to v initial square plus 2a average delta d. Now if I have the variables delta d, v final, delta t and a average, so I am going to write the equation as delta d is equal to v final delta t minus half a average delta t square. Here I have eliminated the initial velocity. If you are not given the initial velocity, you don't need to find it also. You can use this equation. Right, so I hope you understood all of these things. Now coming to the sample problems or the questions based upon these concepts. So we are starting with the first problem. It states a track star aiming for a world outdoor record runs 4 laps of a circular track that has radius 15.9 meter in 47.8 second. What is the runner's average speed for this motion? So we have to find out average speed. Average speed we know has the formula total distance traveled upon the total time taken, right? So he has made 4 laps, right? So he has covered 4 times the circumference. The total distance traveled will be equal to 4 times the circumference, right? So what is the circumference? Circumference is 2 pi r. So the total distance traveled will be equal to 4 times 2 pi r, right? So now when I put the value of r, the total distance traveled will be equal to 8 into pi into r. R is given, it is 15.9 meter, right? So now it will come out to be nearly equal to 4.00 into 10 raised to power 2 meter, right? So he has traveled 4 into 10 raised to power 2 meter distance. Now coming to the v average, v average will be equal to 4 into 10 raised to power 2 meter upon the total time taken, which is given 47.8 second. So when you compute it with the help of calculator, it will come out to be 8.36 meter per second, right? So average speed will be equal to 8.36 meter per second, Now coming to the next question, it states the world's fastest coconut tree climber takes only 4.88 seconds to climb barefoot 8.99 meter up a coconut tree. Calculate the climber's average velocity for this motion, assuming climb was vertically upward. So now we know what is the total displacement. Displacement is 8.99 meter in the upward direction. We know the total time taken as well. And now we know the formula for velocity. It is the displacement over time. So del D upon del T represents my displacement. So what is the del D? It is 8.99 meter in the upside direction. And what is the time? 4.88 seconds. So now when you compute it, it will be coming out to be equal to 1.84 meter per second in the upward direction. So always and always you have to specify the direction whenever you are dealing with the velocity, right? And whenever you are dealing with the speed, you can skip the direction, right? So now coming to the next question, states calculate the slope of given figure and state what the slopes represent, right? So this is a figure. Here you can see at the point A, we know what is the y coordinate, which is representing the position in the west direction in meter, and the x coordinate we also know, which represents the time in second. So we know slope is given by m. It is the change in the coefficient on the y axis, right? So I can represent it as the change in y upon the change in x, right? So what is the change in y? You can see if I take the point O and the point A, so change in y is from 144 and initially it was 0, right? And here it is west, right? So now what is the change in time from 8 to 0, right? So from 0 up to 8 we have change in time, and when you calculate it, it will be coming out to be 18 meter per second in the west direction, right? So now coming to the last question, here we have find the shaded area in the given figure and state what that area represents. This is my figure, and you can see this is my shaded area. This is in the form of rectangle, and I know the area of rectangle is length into width, right? So what is the length? So length is over here 18 minus 0. What is it representing? Meter per second, right? Multiplied with, so it is multiplied with, I will skip the units, I will calculate the unit later on. So it is multiplied with the time. What is the time? From 6 to 4. So 6 minus 4 will be the time, right, in the second. So it is 18 into 2, which is 36 watt. So I have to now calculate the unit. So this was in meter per second. Time is in second. So now we have in meter output. So output is, area is 36 meter, and what is the direction? The direction is west. So area is giving me the displacement. You can see from the unit it is displacement. So let's start with the first problem. It states a cyclist travels 5 km east, then 4 km south, and then 8 km west. Use a scale diagram to determine the resultant displacement and a protractor to measure the angle of the displacement. So we have three displacements of the cyclist. Displacement 1 is 5 km east, displacement 2 is 4 km south, and displacement 3 is the 8 km west. The conventional direction graph is this. So according to the convention, the north direction is this, south direction is this, east direction is this, and west direction is this. Now we have to make a scale diagram. We cannot make 1 km line or 5 km line, so we are going to scale it. We are taking 1 kilometer is equal to 1 centimeter, right? And this is how we can scale it. Now for D1, I will be having, instead of 5 kilometer, I will be having 5 centimeter in east. For D2, we will be having 4 centimeter in south, and for D3, I will be having 8 centimeter in west, right? So how I can plot it? First of all, I will be moving towards 5 km east. This is the east direction. So this is the starting point, let's suppose O, and we have to make a line towards the east and 5 cm in length, right? And after that it moves 4 cm south. So we will be making a line from this point, let's suppose A, and 4 cm to the south. Let's make this angle 90 degree, because east and south are making 90 degree angle with each other, right? So now after that we have the displacement 3, which is 8 centimeter in west. So now we will be making a line of 8 centimeter in west, right? So this is my 8 centimeter line in west, and this was the point B and this is a point C. Now what would be the resultant displacement? The displacement is the distance between the initial and the final point. So this is my initial point and this is my final point. So if I combine these two, right, you will be getting the final displacement. Now you will be measuring this distance and it will come out to be equal to 5 cm. So resultant displacement dr will be equal to 5 km, because 1 cm was equal to 1 km. So what is the direction? It is west of south, right? And if you measure the angle, so angle would come out to be equal to 37 degrees. So 5 km west of south at 37 degree, right? So this is how we can find out the resultant displacement. Now coming to the question number 2, it states determine the resultant displacement in the given figure by applying the Pythagoras theorem and the trigonometric ratios. D1 is given 1.7 km east, D2 is given 1.2 km south, right? So this is the diagram that we have. Now we have D1, now we have D2. We can apply the Pythagoras theorem because these east and south are at 90 degree to each other. This is a right angle triangle. According to the Pythagoras theorem, hypotenuse square is equal to perpendicular square plus base square, right? This identity we know. Now what is the hypotenuse here? Hypotenuse is del dr. So del dr square, we are just talking about the magnitudes, right? So here it will be equal to del d1 square plus delta d2 square, right? So we know what is delta d1. Let's put it. So delta d1 is 1.7, we will be having 1.7 square. Delta d2 is 1.2, so we will be having 1.2 square. It is equal to delta dr square. So when I need to find out delta dr, what I will be doing? I will be taking the under root of these two, right? So under root of 1.7 square plus 1.2 square. Now you can pull out your calculator and you can find out this calculation. So delta dr will be coming out to be equal to 2.1 kilometer. Right, so this is the magnitude. We should know the direction of dr as well. So direction can be found out with the help of tan theta. We all know what is tan theta. This is the angle theta. So tan theta will be equal to perpendicular upon base. So this is my perpendicular. So tan theta will be equal to del d2 upon del d1. So this is how we can find out it. So it will be equal to, what is del d2? 1.2 upon 1.7. So how I can find out theta? For theta, I can have tan inverse of 1.2 upon 1.7, right? So when you find out, it will be coming out to be equal to 35 degree, right? So this is how you can find out the resultant direction as well, right? So it is, what is the direction? It is east of south, right? So now coming to the next question, it states after leaving the huddle, a football team runs 8.5 meter east waiting for the ball to be snapped. Then he turns abruptly and runs 12 meters south, suddenly changes direction, catches a pass and runs 13.5 meters west before being tackled. If entire motion takes 7 seconds, determine the receiver's average speed and velocity. So this is how the receiver has moved. So now it was moving. The first displacement was d1, 8.5 meter east. The second displacement is 12 meters south. And the third displacement is 13.5 meter west. So this is how you can trace its movement. And now we have to find out the v average. For finding out the average speed, we will be calculating the total distance traveled. And we will be dividing it with the total time taken. What is the total distance traveled? First of all, it moves 8.5 meter. Then it moves 12 meter, then it moves 13.5 meter, right? So now when you add all of them and when you divide by total time is 7 seconds. So when you add all of them, so 8.5 plus 13.5, what it would be? It would be 22, 22 plus 12 will be equal to 34. So we will be having 34 upon 7. And when you calculate it, it will be equal to 4.9 meter per second, right? So this is my average speed. This is how we can calculate the average speed. Now coming to the average velocity. So average velocity is represented with a vector sign over it. It can be equal to the displacement over the total time. So what is the displacement? Displacement can be taken from 0 to the final point A. So now you can make a scale diagram, and again you can find out what is the displacement OA. So if you find out OA, it comes out to be equal to 13 meter, and when you divide it by the total time was 7 seconds, so we will be having 1.9 meter per second. This is my average velocity. Now we have to see the direction as well. So direction we can find out with the help of protractor. We will be having direction 23 degree west of south, right? So this is how we can find out the direction as well. Now coming to the last question for the day, we have a motorbike which is starting from rest and undergoing uniform acceleration reaches a velocity of 21 meter per second north in 8.4 seconds. Find the average acceleration. So we have the final velocity, we have the initial velocity, we have the total time. Now the average acceleration is having the formula v final minus v initial upon the change in time. So it will be equal to acceleration average, right? So all of these are vector quantities. So let's put the values. So what is v final? 21 meter per second in the north. So what is v initial? Minus 0. Now again it is in meter per second and the direction is north. It is divided by the total time, which is 8.4. So now when you compute it, so it will be equal to 21 upon 8.4 meter per second square in north direction, right? So when you compute it using the calculator, it will come out to be equal to 2.5 meter per second square in the north direction. So always and always with the vector, you have to denote the directions as well. So the first problem states a cyclist traveling initially at 14 meter per second. So initial velocity is 14 meter per second in south, brakes smoothly and stops. So when he stops, its final velocity will be 0 meter per second south in 4 seconds. So time is also given 4 seconds. What is the cyclist average acceleration? We know the formula of average acceleration, which is v final minus v initial upon delta t. So now what is v final? V final is 0 meter per second in south direction. What is v initial? It is 14 meter per second again in south direction. Now what is delta t? It is 4 seconds, right? So now here I will be having minus 14 meter per second in south divided by 4 seconds. So now when you do the computation, it will be coming out to be equal to minus 3.5 meter per second square in south. So minus represents the north direction. So here minus of south represents north. So it will be 3.5 meter per second in north direction, right? So it's just a convention, right? So now for the motion shown in the figure, find the average acceleration in the segment A, B and C. Now this is the figure, and here in the segment A, if I see the initial velocity, so y-axis represents the velocity, x-axis represents the time. So if I see the initial velocity, it is 10 meter per second, right? So at the initial velocity, I will be putting 10 meter per second and direction is south, right? So now what is the final velocity? It is 30 meter per second in south, right? So now upon what is the total time taken? Time taken is in x direction in second, so it is 5 second, right? So the average acceleration will be equal to 30 minus 10 upon 5, which will be equal to 20 meter per second in south divided by 5, which is equal to 4 meter per second square. Meter per second square is the unit of acceleration in the south direction. Right, so this is how we can find out the acceleration in segment B. Now again following the same procedure in the segment B, now we know V final. V final is 30 meter per second in south. What is the V initial? It is also 30 meter per second in the south. What is the time? Time is 10 seconds for this segment. So it will come out to be 0 meter per second square in the south direction. So 30 minus 30 is 0, and 0 on something would be 0. Right. So now coming to the segment C. In the segment C, you can see what is the V final. V final is 0. What is the V initial? V initial is 30. So 0 minus 30 meter per second in south divided by time. What is the time? Time is 5. So when we have minus 30
divided by 5 meter per second square in south, it will be equal to minus 6 meter per second square in the south. So now minus of south, again it will represent the north, so I can represent 6 meter per second square in north direction. So this is how we can solve the two questions. Now coming to the next question. Starting from rest at time t is equal to 0 second, a car accelerates uniformly at 4.1 meter per second square. What is the car's displacement from its initial point at 5 second? So now we know the equation which relates the initial velocity and the displacement and the acceleration. So this is the equation. The displacement delta d is equal to initial velocity into the time plus half of average acceleration into the time square. So this is the equation. We know the initial velocity is 0 meter per second because it's starting from rest. Right, at rest the initial velocity is 0. A average is given, so average acceleration is 4.1 meter per second square and time is given 5 seconds. So we need to put all of these things in this equation. Delta D will be equal to 0 into what is the time? 5 plus half. What is average acceleration? It is 4.1 into 5 square. So we will be having half into 4.1 into 25, which will be equal to 51 meter in south direction, right? So in the displacement, which is a vector quantity, we have to represent the direction as well. Now coming to the next question, an Olympic driver falls from rest from the high platform. Assume that the fall is the same as official height of the platform above water. So the height is given 10 meter. At what velocity does the driver strikes the water, right? So we need to find out the final velocity. Now initial velocity, because he was starting from rest, initial velocity is 0 meter per second. The height is given, which is 10 meter. Now what is the average acceleration? Average acceleration is the acceleration due to gravity in this case, which is 9.8 meter per second square. So we are taking positive direction in the south direction, right? So let's put all of the values. We know the relationship between V final and V initial. So V final square is equal to V initial square plus 2 acceleration into the displacement. So now what is V final? V final we have to find out. So we can put it as it is, V final square is equal to V initial square will be 0 square plus 2 into 9.8 into 10, right? So now when you do this calculation, it will be coming out to be 196 meter per second, right? It's meter square per second square. Now this is V final square. Now when you have to find out V final, you have to take the under root. So 196 meter square per second square under root. So it will be coming out to be equal to plus minus 14 meter per second. So now the direction is in downward direction. So we know, so we can represent it as 14 meter per second in downward direction. There is no role of negative direction. So now here V final is 14 meter per second in downside. I hope you understood the various questions and I hope you are going to meet me soon in the next class. If you have still not downloaded our mobile app, it is recommended, highly recommended that download our mobile app and do watch our other platforms as well. We are working on Instagram, LinkedIn as well. So you can go to our channel and you can go to our profile on Instagram as well as LinkedIn and you can find the various contents related to you. Thank you so much.